This global pandemic has again driven home the crucial role that our healthcare system plays in our health and our well-being. And tonight, we begin a special series about how we provide healthcare in America, compared with how it's done elsewhere in the world. William Brangham and producer Jason Kane filmed this series in the weeks before the pandemic broke out. And William joins me now to explain a little more about the series. So, hi, William. I know you two work very hard on this. Tell us a little about what the series covers.
Well, as you said, Judy, we started this before the pandemic broke out. And the idea was to look at the state of American healthcare, how it is today. And as you know, this is a country with remarkable innovation in that field, remarkable innovation. And yet this is also a country with incredibly stark disparities. There's over 30 million people who have no health insurance whatsoever. And so we thought, can we learn something from other nations that do a better job of covering everybody? And there's obviously a political side to this. We saw a big debate going on in the Democratic primary. We know this is going to be a big issue in the presidential campaign. Vice President Biden wants to expand the Affordable Care Act and get us closer to universal coverage. President Trump says he wants to get rid of the ACA and replace it with something better and to lower costs. But we thought, since there are so many nations that are already doing a very good job of this, let's go there and see how they're doing it.
So inevitably, as you say, it is going to be a part of the campaign. Where did you go to make these comparisons?
Well, we went to three countries that provide good, inexpensive, universal health care to their people. And there's been this debate happening in this country about, is health care actually a right? These are nations that are not having that debate. They are just doing it for their citizens. And the key metrics that we looked at here are access, quality, cost, and how they take care of the disadvantaged in their societies. And the U.S., frankly, doesn't do that well on a lot of those metrics. So we went to several nations, three in particular, the United Kingdom, Switzerland, and Australia, all of which measure better. And we wanted to see, how do they do it? Let's look at exactly the mechanics of how they get there.
And as you say, you were filming before the pandemic broke out, but of course, since then, it's become a huge public health concern. How did you look at how these countries are dealing with that?
Well, initially, we are not looking at that. We really wanted to stay focused on this issue of universal care, in part also because the way these countries responded to the coronavirus pandemic is only partly influenced by the structure of their healthcare systems. I should say, at the end of this series, we will have a conversation very specifically about how they responded to COVID, but we really wanted to stay focused on, how is it that these countries are able to cover everyone at seemingly a reasonable cost, and what might we learn from that experience? And so for that, we begin our story here in the U.S. in Houston, Texas.
This is a boy saved by American innovation, a bouncing, rocking, joyful testament to the miracles of modern American medicine. His life was transformed here in what's called the largest medical city in the world, the Texas Medical Center in Houston. Here, doctors test artificial organs built from scratch. Technicians design robots to speed efficiency. Surgeons use virtual reality reconstruction to see tumors inside the body before ever making an incision. And kids like six-year-old Kaysen Cox come back from near death. Kaysen was born with only half his heart functioning normally, the hints of blue in his skin, a sign of a little body hungry for oxygen. Most kids with this condition don't live very long.
I can remember it perfectly. It was pouring rain outside, of course, and I was by myself, and my doctor told me that she sees that Kaysen's heart is underdeveloped. It was a very few dark days for me.
But in 2017, using a new and highly complex surgical technique at the Texas Medical Center's Children's Memorial Herman Hospital, Dr. Jorge Salazar changed the course of Kaysen's life.
Kaysen was going to die, and had we done what we've always done, he would have had a transplant already, or it's a hard thing to say, but he would have passed away already. But now we have a normal child in front of us.
Dr. Salazar came out with the biggest smile on his face, and he said, "I did it, you did it, he did it, and it works." So, I mean, I think we all started crying.
You got it?
Kaysen Cox is one story. The Texas Medical Center performs 180,000 surgeries every year. And it, like other gold standard medical centers across the U.S., draw hundreds of thousands of patients from around the world. The technologies and innovations created in the U.S. also get exported globally.
You see what your options are around here. You
just but passed just a few miles away, it's a world apart. In North Houston, the mostly low-income residents here experience a very different healthcare story.
I want you to see that within just a few miles, you have the very best and the very worst. And
it's Elena Marks is the president and CEO of the Episcopal Health Foundation. They analyzed CDC data that revealed incredibly stark inequalities here.
They don't know a discharge date right now.
The mostly black residents here are disproportionately uninsured, and they often don't get care until it's too late. They die, on average, 20 years earlier than residents in other parts of Houston.
You know, the deck's stacked against you. If you could get to the medical center, that would be great, but you'd probably be really sick because of the neighborhood you live in by the time you get there.
The U.S. spends more than $3.5 trillion on healthcare every year. It's nearly a fifth of our economy. As a percentage of GDP, that's almost twice what most developed nations spend. We spend more than all these nations combined. And yet Americans still die of preventable and treatable diseases at higher rates than in other high-income countries. Ours has been called the most expensive, least effective healthcare system in the modern world. Lack of health insurance, or the high cost of healthcare, is a huge barrier for millions. In one recent poll, more than 1 in 3 people said they skipped medical treatment because of money. That includes people with health insurance. And last year, more than 30 million Americans, about 9% of the country, had no health insurance at all. Since the pandemic, an estimated 3 million more joined their ranks. For many years, Houston resident Lakeisha Parker was among the uninsured. She was a certified nursing assistant.
I was proud of that work. I enjoyed doing it because I love to be able to help people. So what I would do is go into people's homes after their surgeries or illnesses and assist them with getting back to life, daily activities of living, bathing, fixing them a small meal,
That's
going to get
their... That's very intimate
work.
It people,
is, right? Very intimate work.
But Parker says the pay wasn't great. She says the most she ever earned was about $13 an hour, and it never came with health insurance she could afford.
I'm actually working in healthcare and can't afford to pay it. That's not right.
Texas has the highest uninsured rate in the nation. Roughly 18% of Texans, 5 million people, don't have insurance. And the state didn't expand Medicaid, which would insure more low-income Texans under the Affordable Care Act. So, like many, Parker went for years without checkups or seeing a regular doctor. Too expensive, she said. But then she discovered a lump the size of a tangerine in her breast. It was malignant cancer.
All right, relax your arm for me. I'll put this in your
Parker brain. Found this Houston clinic that would treat her on a sliding scale based on her income. Only after the cancer diagnosis did she qualify for a special Medicaid program. So the tumor, along with 33 lymph nodes, were removed. While surgery was a success, it, along with the chemotherapy and radiation, left her unable to use one of her arms like before.
Okay, not bad. Okay. Let me feel underneath your arm.
Sure.
Do you think if you had had insurance, you would have found this sooner? You would have been going to the doctor sooner?
If I would have had insurance for me at that time, healthcare that I would have been able to afford, I would have easily accepted it. But again, it comes the question of having somewhere to live, having something to eat, gas to get back and forth to work. So, you know.
Those were the choices you were wrestling with?
Of course. You know, those are everyday life choices that a lot of people have to make based on their income.
The weakness in her arm cost her her job. With no money, she lost her apartment.
And you become homeless if you cannot pay rent. It's
a hard thing. Parker is now homeless, unemployed, and at the time of our interview, living in a shelter.
Houston represents both what is the best of American healthcare and really what is the worst of American healthcare. You have parts of Harris County, which is where Houston is, where life expectancy is lower than what you see in many third world countries.
Dr. Ashish Jha, who's now the dean of Brown University's School of Public Health, traveled with us for this series. He says that the seeming choice between medical innovation and universal coverage is a false one.
I reject that dichotomy as somehow we have to have 20-25% of people uninsured if we're going to have a really highly innovative healthcare system. There are many reasons to reject that. So take a state like Massachusetts, where I live. It's also very dynamic, incredible new innovations happening. And yet pretty much everybody in Massachusetts is covered.
How do we wrestle with this idea that we're in a place with this incredible level of innovation and technological advancement, and yet we are seeing these disparities in healthcare? What is causing those horrible end of the numbers?
So the disparities we see are driven some by high costs. Of course, if healthcare spending was cheaper, it would allow us to cover more people. But there's also a bunch of political choices we've made. We've just decided as a society, not everybody's decided this, but many political leaders have, that it's okay to have people die from totally preventable, totally treatable diseases because we're not going to cover them. That's a political choice. Of course, I think that's a terrible political choice. We can cover everybody in America without bankrupting the country, without creating long wait times. But we have to decide that we're going to do that.
For our next three programs, we travel to the United Kingdom, to Switzerland, and to Australia to look at how they get to universal coverage and what the U.S. might learn.
How's Spider-Man jump?
So that America can both embrace its innovation.
It makes me feel good just to know that he is getting this life that he deserves.
And address its disparities.
We are still citizens. We pay taxes. It makes me feel that we don't matter.
So those two worlds don't remain so far apart. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm William Brangham in Houston, Texas.
And a quick postscript to William's report. Lakeisha Parker has a new job at Amazon. It has benefits, and she will soon be moving into her own apartment.